Kia K5 GT line all-wheel drive.
Yes.
This is new, adding all-wheel drive, and it's only available with the 1.6-liter four-cylinder turbo engine.
Isn't that interesting?
The GT is the one you really want, the one we want. 290 horsepower, 311 pound-feet of torque, but it is an all-wheel drive, and that's okay.
Yeah.
You're watching Everyday Driver. We make a TV show, podcast, and YouTube channels dedicated to great cars, driving adventures, and helping you find a car you'll love. Subscribe and hit the bell so you don't miss a thing.
And I would like to start with the naming convention.
Okay.
Because Kia has this awesome stinger.
They do.
It's a cool name.
It's very cool, yes.
Then they got rid of the Optima, which I always kind of liked because it sounded optimistic for the future. It sounded optimistic. Great.
Optimus Prime. All kinds of great things have been like kind of like that. There you go, yeah.
All good. Mm-hmm. Optimus. They should have gone that direction. Mm-hmm. When you go to a new platform, you don't have to rename the car. It can be the same name, and you just upgraded it, updated it, and it's the same name. Mm-hmm. That's fine. But K5, I mean, we've got Stinger as the big boy. This should be sort of like an advanced concerning rash or some sort of like...
The concerning rash?
You know,
hang on. What's below Stinger? The bruising?
I don't know what... Abrasion?
Okay, yeah.
Something...
Scraper?
I don't know. Quite a sting, but still severe enough to be concerning. But K5, that means nothing. And especially with GT line, which is now a pretty much overused term, it doesn't speak to anything. It doesn't say how good the car is. And the car is good.
It's the GT line, not the GT. And
right.
Like the Camry, you only get that all-wheel drive with the little engine. And I find that thinking just kind of profound.
It's packaging, I suppose. But, it's just mechanicals.
But the reason that Toyota did it, and I expect the same reason they did it here, is because very few people buy the bigger engine.
I'm surprised,
though, that the GT doesn't come with all-wheel drive, because one of my issues here, actually, is that this all-wheel drive feels front-wheel drive.
It is, and it's very much based.
I'm just
saying, based on the hydraulic coupling.
If you put your foot in it, it feels quite front-wheel drive.
Yeah,
and then eventually the back end goes, oh, wait, it's my turn.
But we don't have anything against front-wheel drive.
No.
Hot.
No,
fun
there's nothing,
to drive
there's nothing
kinds
wrong
of car.
With that concept, but this is not, there's nothing performance about this all-wheel drive system.
No.
The
like
big struggle that.
That
I have with this is $32,000.
Just over 31 ish.
And it's good. And you and I are probably going to disagree here. It's good, but this is the Kia product, the first one in a while where I've just been like, don't care.
Okay.
I also think at $30,000-ish, you are list price 10 away from the Kia Stinger, but the Kia Stinger isn't selling. You can get them for a discount, and it is the far superior car in the lineup. I don't think this is worth buying, because I think in this market segment, you're better off in Honda, Camry, or Mazda 6, and Kia has a better car in their own lineup for only a little bit more.
Okay, here's a fly in the ointment.
Sure.
This or a Civic Si for 25. Now, the Civic Si does come with a manual. It only comes with a manual.
Yes.
And this feels like a few big steps in terms of luxury, convenience, build quality.
I agree
with that. Power, even though
I agree with that.
It's a tiny 1.6.
Yes, I
what do
hear
you, think?
You. I hear you, but here's the thing. If
I would take this is the answer. I would take this.
But if you're gonna spend that $5,000 to $6,000 more, you're into all of this car's competitors anyway. You're into the Mazda 6, you're into the Honda Accord, you're into the Camry, and those are very compelling at this level. And I don't remember the Camry all-wheel drive feeling as front-wheel drive as this does. It's front-wheel drive architecture, all-wheel drive as well. I struggle with this being a contribution from Kia in this market segment, but with nothing in it that I feel like really stands out, except for a ton of rear seat space. The packaging here is excellent.
It's
very, very good. So I like that. And we like this brand, and they're doing a lot of good stuff. This, I have to stay there, and I know you're going to drive it, and there'll be many other thoughts, but my big takeaway is I don't like the dynamics enough.
Yeah.
And it's close enough to the Stinger, which is excellent, that I just don't see the point.
This is a brand new architecture on their N3 platform, which is going to spawn all the future Kias.
Mm-hmm.
I love that they're doing this, because this does signify the investment in the future of the sedan.
Yeah, agreed.
And I was a bit mixed. I think I'm coming to this thinking, I wasn't sure the headlight, heartbeat, squiggle, like, that just seems a little bit on the nose.
It's contrived. You know what we could do? We could make this interesting by going, you know, somebody looked at it before they went to lunch, was like, that looks a little mundane. Wait, wait, wait. Let's go to lunch.
Somebody came up behind the designer
sketching. Let's go to
lunch.
We got it. That is solved.
Them,
like, and it's interesting. It's cool.
Oh,
it's
that's kind of cool.
It feels like a graphic off of some other car, doesn't it?
But this platform is wider and longer, and the center of gravity compared to the Optima is lower.
Mm-hmm.
So they are investing in good driving dynamics, even in this midsize class.
Agreed.
Which
Agreed.
Is exciting. Now, again, this is just the GT line. This is not the full GT. Mm-hmm. I think the 290 horsepower, we would really like it.
We'd like it
I
better,
think that
but
would be very compelling.
It's still front-wheel drive architecture. What that one's going to cost Kia
it's
Stinger money.
It's going to cost that much more.
By the way, I'm going to use my throttle. Supposedly the gear shift is inspired after the throttles on an aircraft, which look, okay, yes, I see it, except this is my gear shift. I'm not throttling up. It's not also not a boat.
That's a stretch. With the throttle.
Uh-huh.
Well, let's look at the interior. It's interesting. I think the materials are excellent because at this price point, there has to be some sort of visual interest and it has to feel more expensive to make buyers feel like they're getting something for their money. And even though this is just over 31, somewhere in there, I think this feels a slight bit more expensive than it is. I think it's doing that Mazda 6 and Mazda 3 thing.
I will agree with you there. I honestly saw the price of
this, you think,
and it was $4,000 or $5,000 less than I expected that number to be.
That doesn't happen all the time.
For sure. And I'm not the guy that talks about exterior styling, but there's an interesting trick going on in the back of this car. This has a huge trunk, but it's a trunk. It's not a hatch.
Thank you for bringing that
up. But if you look at it, the rear glass has this bright work that comes around and goes across the...
It's the lasso. It's the lasso.
Oh, good. The same lasso that comes on the Sonata?
Right. That's at the front. This is at the back.
Got it. Okay. So the lasso, it's spreading now. So it's got this piece of bright work that comes and goes across the trunk with black in it that looks, at a glance, you think, oh, it's got a huge back window and a hatch. No, it doesn't. It's got a square back window and a trunk. It's an interesting trick of the eye.
This should have been a hatch. But there's a lot of engineering involved.
True.
And structural rigidity issues you have to solve. Yep. And it's just easier to put a simple trunk on.
It is, and it's, you know, it's a good styling trick because it looks nice, and then you just have the usability of a trunk.
Well, looking around the interior some more, the seats are excellent. The materials are excellent. The interface is excellent, but with the 10.25-inch screen, you do get wireless connectivity, but you don't get wireless Android Auto and Apple CarPlay. You still have to plug it in.
Okay.
It's a little caveat. It's a little like, oh, you got the bigger screen, but we can't give you the tech that you were looking for that should be. So the phone still has to be plugged in for the bigger screen. Otherwise, you do get it, and you get all the rainforest sounds and the people crunching through snow and the coffee and the babies.
Have you bumped into this yet? Because
it forces you to listen to it as soon as you turn it on.
It's the default media setting.
I think this is really something you should take a look at if you like the styling, and it does stand out whether you like the heartbeat thing or not. Mm-hmm. It does have some personality here, but I want to see if there's driving personality.
This is a market segment where the cars don't really look interesting.
And now, this does.
In the case of the Mazda 6, they can look elegant and beautiful, but they don't look cool.
Yeah.
For whatever reason, that little squiggle and the front, the nose of this car looks cool. You're just like, that just looks cool.
It does. I'm really coming around.
And in
I
this
was not
market segment,
first,
that is a weird twist because this is, I mean, think of
it.
Look,
is.
Honda Accord, Camry, Mazda 6,
what?
Hyundai Sonata.
Yeah.
You may like the styling of some of those, but I wouldn't describe any of them as that looks cool.
But then you say the words K5, and nobody knows what you're talking about.
Nobody knows what K5 is.
Like the K5 and the squiggle in the K5. Like,
is that the new printer?
What?
That's the new Office all-in-one, isn't it?
Yeah. It is.
The new HP K5.
It totally is.
Yeah, that's what it is.
You don't know what you're talking about. Well, on an on-ramp earlier, I was chasing an Audi A8L.
That had to go well.
It didn't go well. Oh, look, I'm in sport mode. Okay. Uh-huh. So no paddle, so you have to slide it over just so you can shift with the throttle. It's a weird sentence.
Shift with the throttle.
Shift with the
sure,
throttle.
Let's do that.
Lover. So I was trying to race an Audi A8L. He had a lot of power.
Yes, he did.
But I did pretty well. And that's because of this little engine. And it's 180 horsepower. It is turbocharged, 1.6 liter, and it doesn't sound like much. But it has this continuously variable valve duration, which means at all RPMs, it's continuously variable and giving you, I think, more power than the numbers suggest.
I agree with
which
that.
Which is impressive.
You look at the size of that engine and it's the claimed noisy. Size of power, and you just think, that's going to be abysmal.
Yes.
And you get in and you drive and you think, you know what? He did pretty well.
I'm not A8 level.
Well done.
He just went whoosh.
Of course he
gone.
Did, yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, this is a quarter of the price of that car. So.
Well, and a quarter of all the rest of the stats, too. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it made me feel a little bit better, but there's something here. The point is, there's better power than you think if you opt for the 1.6. It's just enjoyable, and it's comfortable, and it's enough to make me want to buy this over its competitors.
It's a solid execution, but when I actually think of the real competitors, which to me are the Camry and the Mazda 6 and the Honda Accord, frankly, I would buy all three of those before this.
How about an Altima?
On the border.
Really?
On the border.
Really?
Yeah.
I'm trying to throw things in there, but that didn't let me because I wanted a downshift of the throttle. This thing feels like it wants to go faster and wants to do the speed thing and wants to do the sporty driving thing, even though it can't. It's held back.
Yeah.
The architecture suggests that there is more goodness to this car than other cars that are just like, well, we checked all the boxes, and here's your little car, and don't try to drive at 67 miles an hour because you'll be screwed.
Yeah. They.
This can cruise at 80, 90. This is great.
I was comfortable, when I was driving, I kept looking down and surprising myself with how well composed it is.
Yeah.
It's not fun, but it's well set up.
It's wanting to be
and
fun.
And Kia
wants to be fun.
Kia has proven with a lot of the rest of their lineup right now that they understand dynamics and they can set things up well.
I like this car. I think it's great. I have really come around. I was very holding my emotions back, but
okay.
I like it. I think it's a very good choice, very solid. No, it's not sporty driving, but it feels more solid than the numbers and the price would suggest. It feels like a solid, excellent choice.
I will agree with you that I think it feels better than the price and the numbers would suggest. I completely agree
That is a win.
They've done well on that, and they've created something that is surprising with space and usability, and it is interesting to look at and be
in. It is. Just
solid. I still think that it is a total mid-pack finisher in this market segment, and then there's the stinger going, excuse me, you should have gotten me.
With a cool name. The mid-pack rash. Like, back here, Poison Ivy. Something.
The Kia Poison Ivy. And we're done.
Poison Oak. The bumps should go
away. Do not scratch that.
Don't scratch it.
Kia K5, don't scratch that.
Don't scratch that. The bumps will start to bleed.